Everybody, this is Karim Killed the Cat, and welcome to your 24th Lua tutorial. In this tutorial, we'll be going over using variables in the C library and communicating them from C to Lua. So, let's get started. So, the first thing we're going to do is we're going to edit our Lua file a little. So, we're going to... Actually, we can keep hello from Lua. And then, we can just say x equals 10, and y equals hello... and then z equals true. So we just added some simple variables. So now what we're going to do is we're going to try to get those variables from Lua into C. So before we go over the functions that are involved in doing this, we need to go over the general concept of how you communicate information from Lua to C. So let's go to our Lua program, and you can see that we've declared three variables, obviously. And what happens when we declare a variable in Lua, behind the scenes, is that the key and the value, so the name and the value, sorry, my phone just went off, the name and the value of the variable get pushed onto this invisible stack of values. And it's just like a table that holds all the values that were declared in the program, that are still in scope. So x would be pushed in first, so it would have a position of 1, then y would have 2, and z would have 3. And this invisible stack of values is the only way that we can communicate information from Lua to C. So C doesn't have access to everything in the program, it only has access to the things on the stack. And it can only get the things from the stack as raw data, and then we need to convert that data to a number, bool string, or whatever we want to do with it. So that's the general concept of how we do it. So now let's actually do it. So, in the last tutorial, we've run our program, so that's already completed, so test.lua has been run, so it's going to print hello world, and then it's going to push the x, y, and z values we declared onto the stack. So the next thing we have to do is we have to get those values from the stack. And the function for that is lua underscore get global. So, lua underscore get global. And the parameters you pass to it are the Lua state, my phone went off again, sorry, the Lua state, and all the Lua functions besides Lua L underscore new state will take the Lua state. All of them do, there's pretty much no exceptions to that. And then the second value that we have to give it is we have to give it the name of the variable. So let's get the value x. So what we're saying here is that we want to find our variable x on the stack, and we want to push it onto the stack that's shared between Lua and C. They're two separate stacks, and they exist separately. And the Lua stack can only be accessed by C in this way with the Lua get global, or the Lua underscore get functions. There's a few of them that we'll go over in other tutorials. And this is the only way that C can access that stack. And then there's also the Lua C stack, which is what we've pushed x onto with this function. So now that we've done this, we need to convert our variable x from raw data to an int, because it's a number in Lua, so we'd have to convert it to an int in C. So what we're going to do here is we're going to say int x, and this is C's copy of variable x. It's obviously it exists separately from Lua's copy. So we're going to say int x equals Lua underscore to number, and we pass it in L, and then we pass it in the index on the Lua to C stack. So we're going to put in 1, and that's because x is the first value that's on the stack. Because it was pushed in first, it has the index of 1. Even in C, Lua arrays, tables, and stacks have start counting at 1, as opposed to C arrays that start counting from 0. So now what we've done here is we've converted the first position on the stack, which is our variable x, to a number, and we've assigned that to an int. So now if we output this, so we just output x, then if we build this, oh, something goes wrong, one sec. Oh, I need to include IOStream, that's the problem. That should be the only error. Yep, we get succeeded. And we get hello from Lua, which is printed from the program. We never erase that. And then we get 10, which is the value from which is the value of x. And we can also do this for y. But if we try to run it now, then we get 0, because Lua 2 number can't convert a string to an int like that. Or it can't convert a string to a number with this function. We'd have to do this. We'd have to set a constant pointer to a char, which is a C-style string, if you don't know. And then we have to change the function, so we say Lua to string. Not to a string, just to string. So now this should work fine. We get hello from Lua and hello. And then for z, we need Lua to bool. It's boolean, not bool. Oh, I guess that's wrong. One sec. Get Lua underscore to boolean. I must have just spelled it wrong. Oh, it's because we haven't changed the type. So we change this to a bool. And then we get 1, which means true, which is what we set our z value to in the Lua program. So the last thing we're going to do is go over different ways to use the indices in the Lua 2 blank, whatever, variable name functions. So to do this, we're going to get all our values that we declared in our Lua program. So we'll get x, y, and z. So now, x was pushed onto the stack first, so it will be at index 1. Then y was pushed onto the stack, so it will be at index 2. And z will be pushed onto the stack, so it will be index 3. So, I guess just to prove this, we have to change this back to 2 number. So int, actually, an easier thing to do would be just output the values directly instead of assigning them to a variable. So, Lua underscore to number, and we pass it L1, and I'll just copy the output statement. So then this will be at index 2, because it was the second value pushed in, and we also need to change it to 2 string. And this will be at index 3, because it was the third value pushed in, and we need to change it to 2 boolean. And just to make this a bit clearer, we'll say standard bool alpha and standard iOS. Let's see if I remember how to do this. Bool alpha. Okay, I don't remember how to do it. I was trying to make it so that the count statement would print bools as true or false instead of 1 or 0, but I don't remember how to do it. I'm sure you can understand it as 1 or 0. Just 1 means true, 0 means false. And we have to get rid of this. So now we're going to output all of the values that we declared in our Lua program. Index 1 will be x, index 2 will be y, and index 3 will be z. So, we can build it and run 10, hello, and 1, which again means true. But let's say that we didn't know how many values we had gotten from Lua. Like, say this was in a for loop, and we didn't know how high it would count, so we didn't know exactly how many indices there were in the table. So we couldn't really access it like this, because what we're trying to do is we're trying to access the last value that was pushed into the stack. So we couldn't do it like this because we don't know how many values are in the table. So we don't know if there are 3 values in the table or 126. But something we can do is we can access the stack with negative values. So if we were to say negative 1, then that's the equivalent of the last index in the stack. So 1 is the first index and negative 1 is the last index. And then negative 2 would be the second to last, and negative 3 would be the third to last, and so on. So we're pretty much just accessing the stack in reverse order with negative numbers. So this will output the same thing, 10 hello and true. So you'll end up using negative values a lot more than you'll be using positive values to access the stack. It's way more common to access the last index in the stack than the second or third than the first index in the stack. And this becomes especially helpful when we do start to do things where we don't know exactly how many values are in the stack at the current time. So that's all for this tutorial. In the next tutorial, we'll go over calling Lua functions from C, which is slightly more complicated and unfortunately a bit confusing. That's where it really starts to get confusing. But I think you'll be able to do it, so look forward to that, and see you in the next tutorial.